began since the 76 merger. Hembo setting the minimum at 500 games played. Jim, can you name the other two?
I didn't rebound. Let the big fella guess.
Oh, my goodness. Well, Dwight Howard is here, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah.
Dwight Howard is here.
You are the best point.
Do I have a guess?
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, man.
So since 76, 12 rebounds, 500 games played. Who are the guys that you saw getting boards growing up? 12 plus per game.
I'm going to 76.
Since 76.
Since 76.
Yeah, so anytime between 76 and now.
One you can just guess. I think one you can just guess.
I'll guess one. Moses Malone and Dennis Rodman.
Boom! Oh, he got it!
If you didn't notice, eight-time All-Star Dwight Howard is here right now joining us and nailed the three.
And I'll say this, big fella.
I didn't notice.
I just tell you, think about people that was bored when you were growing up.
You're already way better than he is. So, I mean, you know.
He didn't rebound.
I told you.
All right, so you're here. Mm-hmm. We want to talk some Cavs Raptors. I am always interested in hearing what guys playing in the league want to talk about LeBron, because there were some naysayers. And yet, here we are, LeBron dragging his team through these playoffs, sweeping Toronto. His supporting cast has been awakened. But do you buy that now everything's good with this Cleveland squad as we head into the conference finals?
Well, I just thought that they needed time to really build some chemistry. But other than that, you got LeBron James. He's playing great basketball this season. Their whole team is playing really good. You know, I'm surprised to see Kevin Love is playing as well as he's been playing. But other than that, they're the Cavs. They got the best player in the world, and he's been playing like it. So I'm really upset that Toronto got swept. Yeah, I thought it was going to be better.
Now, you've been playing against LeBron for a really long time. Here he is at 33, and as you just mentioned, he's playing as well as he ever has. Can you describe, as an opponent, how he has evolved his game? How is he different now than he was when he was a young player in Cleveland back when you were in Orlando?
Well, I don't really think he's... I think he shoots a lot better. I think his jump shot is a lot better. But other than that, he's LeBron. You know, he's going to get to the basket. He's going to finish. He's going to dunk on a lot of guys. And he seemed like he put a lot of fear in the Raptors. You know, I thought Serge and Valanciunas were really going to dominate the inside, and LeBron just ate them apart.
What about your level of disappointment for the Raptors? A number one seed, they've been in the playoffs with this same group multiple years.
Right.
To get swept back-to-back seasons, even though the Cavs have LeBron. Just talk about it, somebody that's been in the league all year. Like, did you expect a better showing from this squad?
I expected more. I expected more. You know, playing against the Raptors all year, those guys were tough, and it was hard to even score on those guys. You know, because you got Serge, you got Valanciunas, and then you got OG, the Star Wars character. He's pretty tall. He's playing great basketball. So I was really shocked to see them get swept by the Cavs.
All right, now out west, we've got the Rockets that are sort of beelining into Golden State, and we'll see if they're able to get over that hump. Daryl Morey has made no secret about Houston's obsession with the Warriors over the years. Of course, he spent some time in Houston. So as you look at what they've done out there and you see these two teams and play against them all year, do you think Houston, we're sort of fast-forwarding to the finals of the conference now here, do you think Houston is able to give Golden State a real scare or maybe even beat them?
They
you
can.
Do?
I think so.
How so?
I think when we played them in the Eastern or the Western Conference Finals a couple years ago, I think that lit a fire into James. You know, he was very upset at how that season ended, and he came back the next season, and the year after that, he's gotten better every single year. So I think because of him alone, you know, they have a chance. But then you had a guy like Chris Paul, then you got Trevor Ariza. They got a great bench now. They got really good wing defenders, and I think that's going to be the key. You got to have somebody that's big and strong enough to handle a guy like Kevin Durant. You're not going to stop him. He's still going to score. But they have multiple guys that can step up and guard Kevin Durant.
Now, I wonder sometimes about the pressure that's on these guys. We talk about the Raptors. We know about their history of failure in the playoffs. And it seemed as though they were tight at times perhaps here. And you look at James, who's your teammate. Again, brilliant regular seasons. But we know the playoffs have not been kind to him. And Chris Paul really has a similar history. Right. So how much pressure is on those guys? And how, as an active player, how do you handle that? How do those players handle that spotlight?
Man, you got to just go out there and just play. It's once in a lifetime, you know. It's a lot of guys who played in this NBA, Jalen can attest to it, who've never made it to the playoffs. So when you get an opportunity to make it to the playoffs and do damage. You get a chance to play in the Western Conference Finals. You got to take advantage of that moment. You know, I thought going to the finals in Orlando, I saw the blueprint. I was like, oh, man, I can go every year. This is it. But I haven't been since, you know, so it's very hard to get to that level. So I would just say, you know, for James and his crew, this is their moment. You know, it'd be tough to, I don't know if I could watch them win a championship, this is their moment. They've been playing great all year. Chris Paul, James, Clint Capella has had an amazing year. Their whole team, you know, Trevor, you got Joe Johnson, you got Mike D'Antoni, you know, I'm happy for him, you know. So it's going to be a tough series, but I think if they play 48 minutes every night, they can win.
I know hindsight is 2020. You had a terrific year this season in Charlotte. But since you left Orlando, it's been a couple of teams trying to find your way. Mm-hmm. You had your most success in Orlando when Stan Van Gundy was your coach who just got let go by Detroit. So any regrets on how your situation ended in Orlando?
No regrets. I think everything happens for a reason. I've learned and I've grown since then. I was 18 when I went to the Magic. I was basically a little kid, you know. And I think out of all those years, I think experience and opportunity as a basketball player is what you need. And in Orlando, I had my best opportunity because what was given to me, I was in the right system. I had the right pieces around me. And the other teams I went to, the opportunity just isn't the same. And as you know, the NBA is all about opportunity and system. You look at a guy like Rondo, he's been bouncing around from team to team. He's still that same Rondo. He got an opportunity this year, and he's getting 20 assists in games, and he's made their offense look amazing. Playing against them, I'm like, man, Anthony Davis, all he got to do is run and jump. He doesn't have to really do a lot of moves, and he's scoring at will, you know, so it's always about opportunity and system.
Is that still out there for you? In your mind, do you believe that opportunity, the right place and the right system is out there for you to be back on that stage again?
No doubt. I think this year in Charlotte, it really opened my eyes to a lot of things, and I think the years that I've had before Charlotte, it really just kind of woke up the inner Dwight, I would say. And I'm like, man, I'm really excited about next season to go out there and dominate.
Who was the inner Dwight?
Man, I think I lost a little bit of the passion that I had for the game because of the business side of it. And I think every NBA player can attest to that.
Yes.
That the business side can cause you to really lose some passion. I know a lot of people like, how? You're getting paid millions of dollars. But for Jalen and myself, the game is much bigger than just the dollar amount. You know, we love having money in our pockets and being able to travel the world, but we want to win and we want to be able to show the world our talents. And I think I lost some of that passion for the game.
Can you go a little bit deeper and say when you lost the passion? Because for me, like getting traded a couple of times, being bounced around, mm-hmm. trying to find that system, trying to find right. happiness. And sometimes your minutes doesn't match your contract and things are like that. So when did you lose the passion?
I would say after the situation in Orlando, where everybody felt as though I was this big, mean, crazy guy that I just wanted to destroy franchises. And I go to L.A. and it seemed like me and Kobe didn't work. I lost some of that passion then. You know, I'm like, man, I had back surgery. I wasn't supposed to play for a whole year. I came back, tore my labrum, still played, and just seemed like I couldn't find a break. So I kind of lost some of that passion.
I'm glad you mentioned that. Like, how do you get that back? Because you know that the labels that have followed you around, mm-hmm. and when you say things like that, like you want to destroy franchises or coaches or what have you, how do you get past those types of labels?
Oh, man. What I did was just, first I started to watch a lot of YouTube videos of my younger self to see how I was when I was at my peak. And then I just got in the gym. You know, I would say when I went to Atlanta, I just started to go around different gyms and just playing basketball and just watching people play. And I just went back to that moment that got me to where I am today. And that kind of just boosted my confidence and also my passion for the game.
So to sort of circle it back to where the conversation began, though, you said you don't really have regrets. Is there any part of it that you would like to go back and do over again? Is if you had the opportunity to, I understand.
I would just say being able to voice my, you know, myself. You know, I think throughout all the years, I just allowed people to say whatever they want, and now everybody has their opinion of who I am, and that's really not who I am as a person or a player. So that's the only regret, but I think everything always happens for a reason, and I will always stick by that. My time in Orlando was kind of like everybody was just giving things to me. It was all yes people, not just the people around me, but just everybody, and I felt like I was just too comfortable. And I think sometimes in life, you got to go through experiences and get out your comfort zone to get to where you really need to get to.
It's a great conversation. We're going to continue it in a moment. Dwight Howard is here, and he will stay with us as we go. I would also like to mention very quickly that we have Wednesday.